All right, everyone, welcome back. Vlogcast number... Fuck.
What was it?
All right, everyone, welcome back. Vlogcast number 25. Software, why in the goddamn building? And, of course, it is myself, Christian Soto, my main man, Matt Berkey. Clearly, you can see he is from Pittsburgh. You a proud young man today?
We back, man.
Tell me about it.
Winning record 5-4. Won
nice.
Won 4 of the last 5, I think.
That's a good thing. What do you think has changed?
Nothing. They've gotten a little bit luckier.
Nice.
Here's the thing. They got blown out by the Patriots week 1. Ben Roethlisberger gets hurt, out for the season.
Mm-hmm.
All of the year is done and over with. What they forgot was we have the best goddamn defense in all of the NFL.
That seems to be a trend with that team often.
Yeah. And, you know, they lost really close games. They lost to the Niners on a last possession, Seattle on a last possession, Baltimore on a final possession. These are three huge playoff-bound teams. You know?
Right.
We easily could be 7-1 right now.
7-1. Oh, okay.
8-1.
You're the fucking Niners and shit now. All right. Well, we're back. It's good to be back. And there's a lot to talk about today. So quickly, we're going to give people a rundown of what we're going to do. We're going to talk about player of the year. Obviously, that's going to be a talking point. And then we also have a little, let's say, holiday gift that we want to provide the people. And we're going to talk about that. Of course, we're going to talk about my fitness bet. If anybody has followed me on Instagram, you know what's up. You know I'm taking long walks to the gym. And if you
Sounds
don't follow
romantic.
Me, yeah, if you don't follow me on Instagram, it's Christian Soto 08. If you don't follow Berkey 11, I don't know why you are even tuned into this channel. So let's begin with player of the year. There was a mishap, potentially.
That's a polite way of putting it.
Yeah, you know, I'm trying to keep, you know, these people are over there, you know, maybe they want to sponsor the show. I don't want to ruffle the feathers. That's it. Is that an idiom also?
That is an idiom. A colloquialism almost.
What's the difference of that shit?
Colloquialisms are just like local, more like cultural dialect.
And these are like well-known.
Yeah.
Like international.
That's a good question. I'm not sure. Probably all English-speaking nations. But I could be wrong.
I'm going to ask our British friend.
I'm very certain that I'm probably loosely interpreting right now, and I'm just going to get hammered in the comments.
All right. So... WSOP misplaces the points for Daniel Negreanu. They give him a cash in a 1K online bracelet event that he did not cash, but Amanda Leatherman, formerly Leatherman, I believe, did cash. So,
which is meaningless.
Yes, but some people have brought that point up in terms of like you knew she cashed or you didn't know that you didn't cash because you're obviously probably playing alongside her or whatever. So, you know, suspicions. Drama.
Sure.
So, Sean Deeb loosely accuses. Or formally accused.
Yeah. He said he cheated.
You know, trying to be nice. Maybe Sean D wants to sponsor the show. He owns a couple firehouses, you know. He accuses Daniel Negreanu of cheating. And the beneficiary of all of this is, of course, the player that did end up winning. I believe his last name was Campbell.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I mean, it was a big dramatic thing. What do you believe should be the stance of... Well, let's begin with WSOP.
Yeah, so it's pretty unfortunate. You know, they're pretty restricted. Obviously, I know a lot more of what goes on there than most people do, but they take a lot of heat because they are an industry leader and their name is on the forefront of everybody's tongues anytime that something poker related, more specifically tournament related, is being spoken about. So whether it's the online or live side, they're just pretty restricted by their platform. You know, they're partnered with 888 on the online side, and in the live realm, it's a huge operation. So unfortunately, all of this stuff isn't automated the way it should be.
Right.
And I anticipate that we'll probably see some changes, albeit slow. But yeah, I mean, like, errors occur all the time in all realms. The problem with this whole thing is that they don't get the chance to correct because it's such a community-wide topic.
Yeah.
Basically, people are going to be crowning Negreanu the second that Deeb gets knocked out worse than fifth.
They don't get a chance to, like, audit.
Right. Nobody really fact-checked. Right. We just took everybody's word for it that Deeb needed fifth to win, and that was the sweat. And that's reasonable.
But, you know, there is some... Shouldn't they have audited knowing that, you know, this is coming to a close?
I mean, they should, because they don't get to after the fact.
Right.
And they're kind of forced to go public and say, like, congratulations to Dan Negreanu on Player of the Year, and then retract that 24 hours later.
Correct.
And to be fair, I'm not sure if they would have caught it or not had our Russian friend not found his way into the point system to double check everything.
Maybe he hacked it.
Sure, like the election?
Yeah, he hacked that shit. He doesn't like Daniel.
Maybe he had big bets.
Let's talk about a little gift before we move on to a new topic. So, November 18th, end of year holiday gift. So, let's play the ad.
Coming to Solve for Y is what really kind of forced me to rethink everything and just completely change the way I played the game, especially in the cash game mentality. You get this lens that you wouldn't get anywhere else.
So I've been a member of various training sites over the last few years, started researching Solve for Y and been diving into the rabbit hole ever since.
We are pretty much marrying the GTO approximation of the spot and our blockers and all these things to the profiles.
And there's some hands that are just too low equity to really be able to bet with any significant frequency. I think it should make sense to everybody watching this why betting 7-5 of diamonds is not going to make a ton of money.
It gives me some confidence to, like, not put so much pressure on myself when I do go play and say, okay, sometimes I am gonna mess up and that's okay, you know?
Theoretically speaking, this is almost exclusively gonna be a call spot. You're just not really incentivized in position to be raising much of a range.
I think a lot of our opponents are gonna fail to defend as much, and some are gonna drastically fail.
You get to actually hear step by step people's thought process as they're making decisions and taking actions inside of the game of poker.
I don't really think over-limping is too viable of an option. I don't really want to play multi-way pots at this stage of the tournament.
You're going to take away something from one of those players around the table that will stick with you as you develop your own game.
You're not going to see a lot of videos on the training site of, you know, how to c-bet on this specific board texture.
This information is really critical. Even if you're not a leader or an innovator, it's incredibly important to understand what you choose to follow.
All right, we have two tables running. Day 5 of the gameplay.
Solve for Y has torn everything that I know about strategy away and then solidified a foundation and built it back up from nothing. I think without Solve for Y, I would be broke.
All right, so they can get one free month. You're back to giving things away using S4Y gift.
Yeah.
Tell the people a little bit about this.
The letter S, number 4, letter Y, gift. So effectively, we are just doing an end-of-year holiday sale. We have a site relaunch coming up in the near future. It'll probably be sometime, I'm hoping for January 1. And we just want to give everybody a chance to experience the training site. So utilizing the coupon code S4YGIFT, you'll get one free month of the site. And then if you like what you see, we're also running a special on a year-long subscription.
It is an end-of-year Black Friday promotion. Regular price is $1,199. It is now $999. Use sign-up code TRAININGSEASON. If you like training day, you'll like training season. If you like training for losing body fat, you'll like training season. this is training season, and this is the realest fucking podcast. It's real, man.
Offer expires December 31st.
All right. So, I was on Poker Masters. They gave me a microphone just like this one. They didn't let me speak this loud, though. Mm. And I commentated the short deck. 10K final table. The winner was Jonathan Deppa. And I was very impressed by his gameplay. And, of course, I was impressed because I don't even play the game. They gave me the microphone. I was like, okay. I played this a couple times before.
A couple times?
Probably like a handful of times.
A handful of times?
Not professionally, for fun with my friends.
You've played in a casino?
No.
So you've never been dealt a hand
of short deck? I played on the kitchen table.
Right, so you've never been dealt a hand of short deck. You played on the kitchen table versus other people who have never been dealt a hand of short deck?
Yes.
Right. So effectively.
But I also watched the streams.
Hey, to be fair, yeah. My first hand of short deck ever, 300, 600.
Yeah, that's... I think I was a little more responsible than you. But you also won a lot more than me, so there's that. Thanks, Benbo.
I've played against Deppa in those short deck games. He ruined them.
Yeah, well, he came...
He doesn't know he ruined them, but he ruined them.
Yeah, because he came with the correct strategy.
Yeah, it was annoying. Like, I was in there just low-key, winning a little bit here and there. Everybody was limping along, real splashy, seeing too many flops multi-ways. And then Deppa comes in, he's like, you opened? I'm all in.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, but I have queen jack suited. He's like, yeah, I'm all in.
So I'll tell you what I did. I'll tell you how. So I was like, okay, I'm going to play a little bit. So we kind of like set up a little bit of like, you know, kitchen home games, short deck. And then I got a little bit of like just the pulse of how the game plays so I could get into the shoes of the players. Mm. And then I put on like two different streams with a little bit of like my notepad out. And just like I put on two different streams from the Triton series, and I was like, okay, like I wrote out like this is how the game is, like, you know, all these antes, like what should you be doing? And then I kind of compared it to like No Limit Hold'em, and yeah. I'm like, okay, well, in No Limit Hold'em, like what would be our incentives here? And then I just changed the rankings of the hands and then inserted them, and it's like, okay, well, this is relatively simple. Like, there are certain hands that want to move all in and push all these other hands out, and then there's another range that's polarized.
Yeah.
Okay, that's the game.
Yeah.
And just follow your incentives. So it was kind of crazy just because I felt as if you understand incentives, if you understand the structure of the game, and you understand polarity pretty much, then you can just transfer all these concepts that we teach here at Solve4Y onto all other big bet games.
Yeah, and I think that stands the test of time. I think people who are very strategic at No Limit Hold'em are often just good at big bet games to begin with. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's any shock that some of the best short deck players in the world were also highly regarded No Limit Hold'em players. And I think like the only challenge with this game is that it's kind of comparable to PLO in the sense that polarization isn't very absolute.
Mm-hmm. Right, the board changes quickly.
Right, you don't really get too many big advantage textures. So money often goes in really early in hands. The incentives shift a little bit. River play is kind of often forgone. But it's also very early in the evolution of the game. No Limit Hold'em was this way too whenever it first started. We played very shallow. My first game was only 40 big blinds deep. Mm-hmm. And that was a byproduct of people not wanting to make complex river decisions. Eventually, they're going to stop letting people go south in these games. Eventually, you're going to have to play 300, 500, 1,000 antes deep. And, you know, the complexities are really going to ring true.
You know, this morning, and I shared this with you, Deppa sent me a message on Instagram. And he said, like, hey, like, you did a really great job. It was a pleasure. And this was really nice because I usually just watch the streams on mute.
Right.
Which is like one of the best compliments I could ever get, right?
Yeah.
So, especially from someone of his caliber in this game. So, that was really nice. Yeah, I mean, I'm excited to potentially work further with them. And that's it, really. I just wanted to kind of give people an update on that. So, I am going to head back to Jersey, see my beautiful girlfriend who is dying to see me, hates that I see you more than her. That is actually... That's true, actually. She says that. But I am making sure that my fitness bet stays intact as it pertains to me staying on the course. So what would you suggest? What are, you know, people that are out there traveling for work, for whatever, and they have these goals of, you know, trying to stay, you know, on track or whatever. Like, you know, we travel more than the average person.
Yeah.
And it seems like, what would be your plan? So I want to talk about two things, both the plan of me going back home and what I should probably do to stay on the focus, because it's easier here, you know?
Yeah,
right. And then secondly, like, you know where I'm at as it pertains to like my, like this journey. How do you see this journey playing out?
Sure. So I think first and foremost, the idea of like traveling and trying to stay regimented, the big thing that you want to avoid is being spontaneous. And I don't mean that as a life thing. I just mean it when it comes to your routine.
That's right. Because my girlfriend likes the spontaneous.
Sure. You can woo all you want. Just do it outside of the window of X, Y, and Z that you've laid out for your regimen.
Got it.
And I think that that's like super critical. I think it's really easy to like travel to another place and you're used to working out between 8 and 10 a.m. every single day. But suddenly because you're somewhere else, you either sleep during that time or you just find something else to occupy your time with. And
right, absolutely.
Now it's noon and you're like, I don't feel like going right now. I'll go later today. And you just keep pushing off.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. So keeping that discipline up in terms of you have to work out today, even if the hours somehow changed, like this needs to get done.
Yeah. I mean, like for me, I just like try to give myself one or two windows that I can fulfill. And that way I don't feel like stressed or pressure if I exhaust one of them. Mm-hmm. If I give myself 8 to 10 a.m., but I'm super tired and I sleep till 9:30, then I'll just say like, okay, well, I also have 1 to 3 open.
Yeah.
And I'm just going to have to like fulfill that with my obligations. Yeah, same thing holds true with work. But hey, I might not be the person to ask for all this because as regimented as I am in my day-to-day when it comes to getting shit done, I am absolutely absent whenever it comes to not being overwhelmed by tasks,
and
staying social and paying attention where it's probably a lot more important. I never thought like I would be one of those guys who lets the job overtake things. I never was in poker.
Right.
Like no matter how hard I grinded, no matter how much I aspired to be the best in the world, I always seemed to find more time for friends, family, significant others or whatever than I ever did to go play. And I remember I used to like stress over it when I was in my 20s because when you're in your mid-20s, late-20s, all you are thinking about is the traditional pressure of like, I got to get a career and get married and have kids. And you feel like that's like breathing down your neck. And at the time, it's like I'm like 26, 27. I'm making six figures every year playing this game. And I'm just thinking to myself, like, how could I ever sustain like answering to a family whenever it's a random Wednesday and so-and-so just showed up and I have to go play?
Yeah.
So like I struggled with that for a long time, but despite my worst fears, I never, they were never an issue, right? Because like there's just so much freedom in playing. Starting a business is different.
That's true. It's way different. There's deadlines. There's things that need to come out at a certain time. This podcast you listen to launches every goddamn Monday at 4 p.m.
Mm-hmm.
And it better be out there or else Conrad is fired.
That's right.
You heard Conrad? Don't delete this. But yeah, in terms of discipline, yeah, there's definitely going to need a balance. Like, you know, obviously my girlfriend's really excited for me to go home and she's going to want to spend time together. So right. I need to get, you know, I have a lot of work to do for Solve for Why. So I'm already allotting like, okay, she's working X amount of time to X amount of time, you know, so that's my window to like get all my work done and like go to the gym, or maybe we could go to the gym together. She wants to do that. So that's nice. But in terms of like dedicating Solve for Why time, like that's my window right there. If I miss that window, like I'm done for the day.
Yeah,
you see what I'm saying?
Yeah. And I think like I think that you'll kill it because you have the framework and like your mindset is there. It's when you begin to get too overwhelmed.
Yeah.
And like something has to give. So like, you know, for a fact, you have to sacrifice something because of work, life, play, social, all this stuff. You're just looking at your plate and you're like, okay, it's genuinely too full. Yeah. And I have to consciously sacrifice something, but I don't want to choose.
Yeah. And then everything. Yeah.
For me personally, whenever that happens, I just immediately shut off. And when I shut off, like, unfortunately, the people around me just like are the first ones to Yeah. Basically, they get the shit end of the stick.
For sure.
In all capacities. And it's never intentional, but it's one of those things where it's like, well, something had to go and everything else had a deadline. I don't mean to make you expendable, but unfortunately, like, I don't have the mental capacity to fix this.
Yeah, and I mean, that's what's going to happen. Like, you know, we spoke about this last night. You know, obviously, like, you know, we live in a close proximity. Not, well, upstairs and downstairs. You know? and, you know, we're good friends and, like, we have a business. So it's like there's so many moving parts in all our relationships. You know, like, we're both roommates and friends and business partners and peers in poker. You know, there's so many things. Like, so, yeah, man, shit happens. Shit is real. This podcast is the realest fucking podcast, man. and so as it pertains to moving forward for the year, right? So mm-hmm. I'm trying to begin planning out for the year. So I, at least initially, I'm thinking like, okay, I lost like 40 pounds with the ketogenic diet, yeah. right? And I was really happy with that. But, you know, at least the outlook for me is like, I definitely feel like I need to build some muscle, right?
Yeah.
And so I'm thinking of like switching the macros in an inverse way where it's like, high protein, moderate fat, low carbohydrates now instead of like the high fat, moderate protein, low yeah. carbohydrates. What are your thoughts on that?
So I don't know if you're still deep in ketosis. I know you just did that long fast and mm-hmm. you were really deep in ketosis. I would take advantage of that if you are. And I would do a fuck ton of cardio for like, I would probably give like keto maybe 2.5 weeks or so, especially since you're traveling.
Yeah.
It's super easy to fast.
Yeah.
Whenever you're flying across country. And also now it makes the inconvenience of being home and having to try to figure out like when you can work out, what you're going to do. Like that anxiety of trying to build a program every single day,
mm-hmm.
it's a lot. It's overwhelming. So when I'm the busiest is whenever I would prefer to be much more in that foundational phase. And I think it benefits you long term because if you can get your wind up and like really get your VO2 max to be of high capacity, that means that now whenever you do cycle into more of a maintenance diet where you're trying to pack on muscle, you're going to be able to endure a lot more.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which I think is like pretty critical.
I agree with you. I think I'm going to do a ketone test and then see where I'm at as soon as I either get home or as soon as. Right before I'm going to leave. That way I know.
I mean, you can test it at my house. I have a
yeah, I know.
A blood thing.
I know. I used it. You weren't there.
Sure.
I still a little needle. I get scared.
$7.
I get scared of it, man. You know how many times I was like, I don't want to press it.
for anybody who doesn't know, it's literally like one of those diabetic pens where you're testing your glycogen. They also have, or your glucose levels. They also have them for your ketone levels.
Yeah.
So, I mean, literally, it's like taking a thumbtack and pricking the tip of your finger.
Listen, if I grab the thumbtack right now and told you to prick it, you're not going to just be like hyped about it.
I'm not going to be hyped about it, but like just Jesus Christ.
I did it, man. I goddamn did it. Holy shit, man. I didn't like it. I do want to take this time to thank all the people that did, you know, send me a message on Instagram. I actually posted our wager and like the goals and things like that. And people like really came out and I was really kind of like astonished of how many messages were like, oh, you can do it. Like, you know, get your mind locked in, like all these things. And it's like, I almost like feel like they're following along now as it yeah. pertains to like, okay, like let's see if Chin can actually get this done. Some people were like, Berkey could kiss that 25,000 goodbye. Like, those were fun to see. And then another person was just like, steroids, only way you win. Like, I wonder if he talks like that too. Like, steroids. But yeah, I mean, it's really overwhelming to get that much support. So we're going to have Joey Ingram.
Yep.
And I haven't really listed out a topic because that will be a discussion between you two. But I am curious as it pertains to what you would ideally envision a conversation of you two looking like.
My whole thing is that like, I came to know Ingram through social media and his own platform and everything else. And
you ever called him Poppy or what?
No, I won't call anyone Poppy.
That's right.
I think that's weird.
Yeah. There's only one Poppy in this room. I'll tell you that.
David Ortiz. That picture back there. So I just think like I'm not alone in the sense that I doubt very few people really know a ton about his backstory.
Right.
I've heard bits and pieces. And
I know about the big prop bet that he had about playing like a bunch of hours.
Yeah.
And then there was another prop bet where he had to like write a book.
Right.
So those are the two things I know.
And I think all that stuff's interesting, but I'm not even sure how long he's been in the game. Yeah. My best estimate would probably be like 12 or 13 years.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a great interview.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to...
Do we look at the cameras in this scenario?
No.
Okay.
Never.
Oh, this is perfect. I love this. Okay.
Just you and me, buddy.
Well, I always stare at the camera when I'm doing mine, like when I'm talking to someone. So this is a lot different. Okay, you have to look at our person. This is way better.
Yeah.
I like this.
This will be intimate.
Okay.
This isn't really an interview per se. This is...
conversation.
Yeah, it's a conversation.
It's like the normal thing we might do normally if we're talking or...
Right.
Even on my show, we're talking to each other. It's not like I'm interviewing you. It's like we kind of throw a topic out there and we speak about it for a little while.
Well, that's kind of the irony. That's why I was like so pumped to do this, is because truthfully, I don't know you outside of the podcast.
No, most people don't.
Right? It's like, I mean, we've had a lot of conversations on and off air, but
yeah,
the vast majority of it has been me getting to know you through your podcast in some capacity, mm-hmm, either as a guest or you know, just somebody viewing from the outside looking in.
Mm-hmm.
So first question, we have a scandal on our hands already.
Okay, do we?
When I was digging through the Ingram files,
oh boy, okay,
trying to got? Learn a little something.
What do we got?
I found a lot of things that said you're 37 years old.
What?
And then I found an Upswing article that said you're 33.
What?
I'm just telling you.
Who said I'm 37? I was like, what scandal? What happened now? Like, Postle? Like, I see Postle there. I'm like,
yeah.
Is this Postle related? Like, what happened with Postle
well,
now?
Well, the Postle thing, I was going to put a big X over it, like, try to figure out a way not to bring it up.
Yeah,
but,
I agree.
Yeah, so are you 33 or 37? Or neither?
No, 34.
Okay, so so the episode.
It's about right. I don't even know how they came to 37, though. That's kind of,
it
that's
said
a little...
like July 24th, 82, I think.
Oh, July 24th, 85. June 24th, 85.
Listen,
I don't know.
The month right.
I vaguely, like, if I look for, whenever I get photos of myself for Photoshop for thumbnails, I'll Google my name and I'll look for stuff. But I never really have looked at any articles before. And sometimes I'll click on an article and then I saw something weird like that before where it said, like, my age. I was like, wait, where do they make?
Well,
how can they
fair,
be this
the
incorrect about
found,
this stuff like that? I just don't understand.
The first one I found was, like, some off the wall, like, Asian site that was just trying to boom poker over there for sure.
Oh, shout to Asia. Okay.
But
putting him in Asia in there. Okay.
What I'm guessing is a bunch of other articles use that one as a source.
Well, that's usually, that makes sense, right?
Yeah.
I mean, something like this happened, UFC video I did initially, right? Like my source was an article and then it was wrong. I'm like, well, that's not good.
Yeah.
Make a correction video about it, right? So it's like,
yeah,
that,
yeah.
It seems easy to let that happen where you're just like, well, my source is this person. And then,
right,
it gets like this chain reaction. So I think this is what happens a lot of times in content or media. It's like they don't really check with the actual source. They just check with this random source that they believe to be true just because someone posted about it or read about it. So
yeah. So let's talk about that a little bit. I mean, I'm going to go a little bit out of order, but I'm versatile here.
I feel like you're going to do well. I think you'd pick it up quite nicely.
Well, thanks. I got to tell you, I don't feel comfortable as the interviewer, but
it's like the conversation. It'll be okay.
So with the Postle thing, like you kind of mentioned, also with the UFC thing,
mm-hmm,
there's a huge due diligence that we have to do as content creators, or at least a presumed one, right?
Mm-hmm.
I guess like you don't have to. You could just go the clickbait route and just put whatever the hell inflammatory shit you want.
Right.
But speaking for myself, I was most interested in getting to the bottom of something to protect the community. You seemed like you were aligned with that message and were just trying to get to the... You started very neutral. I'll give you a lot of credit.
I was trying.
You started
I was neutral, right?
Sure.
So, well, I messaged the guy, right? I messaged Mike Postle and I say, Mike, what's up with these hands? You know, this looks suspicious.
Yeah.
The guy's nice to me. You know, he says he's a fan and says, I didn't do it. He gives me these explanations, right? I believe the guy, right? Like, why wouldn't I believe this dude?
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
I have no reason not to believe the guy. A couple people vouch for him. I say, okay, let me take a more neutral standpoint and look into this sort of thing like that. And then, so I think you mentioned, you know, we have this do our due diligence, right? And
yeah,
I've come to that conclusion over time because what I found is that when I don't, then you get these comments that they can refute what you say,
right,
kind of easily in some ways. Like, well, did you ask that person? I go, well, I didn't. So in order to make a better argument or present a better case or present better evidence for whatever it is that you're trying to come up with, I found that it's just much better to do the due diligence. And what happens oftentimes then when you ask the people, they're going to tell you something. And I found that a lot of times they're lying about these kind of things, right?
Sure.
So now you say, well, I did speak to them. This is what they said. And then you find evidence that says that. And you say, well, I mean, now I for sure, I think that they did this kind of thing like that, right? Yeah, yeah, so that's what it seems like to me is what's happening so far with the idea of asking both sides and kind of getting that feedback. And I'm thinking about this Negreanu thing, actually, right? I don't really, for this situation, I guess I haven't taken, you know, I'm just very, I'm kind of not even.
It's whatever. You're allowed to be personal.
Right. I'm like, oh, I don't even want to fucking even get into that kind of thing too. But I'm going to have him on a show and kind of ask him about it and kind of go from there, see what he says. And, but it's you learn from your mistakes in the past, right? Yeah. You learn from the way you handle things and what happens, what you liked, what you didn't like, what you thought was unfair, what you thought was fair. And I'm trying to be a lot more fair about the process because now you see the influence, something like you say come out or something like I come out. And if we come out and we're very incorrect about something, well, then that's going to impact these people. And I want to be very right about these kind of things if I'm going to make some sort of definite stance on something like that.
Yeah, I think that's really critical. You kind of like already nailed the follow-up. I think it's really important that if we're going to start trying to find some sort of bridge between poker and more mainstream communities, and we're going to be doing it through methodologies where we're talking about truths, whatever they may be it, you know, talking about lifestyle, being talking about our paths up until this point. I think one of the big things that's plagued poker throughout the decades is that ego has gotten in the way of a lot or so much, where people want to put themselves up on a pedestal. They want to be known as a crusher. They want to celebrate all of these huge wins. They want to kind of like be basked in the glory of choosing this non-traditional path. Mm-hmm. But we know the dark, cold hard truth there, right? It's like most people are failing, if not almost everybody across the board. It's really hard start to finish to have a career where you don't suffer through some low times. You know, we kind of like do a really shitty job of being empathetic to those who go broke, to those who are struggling in any capacity.
Do we? Oh yeah, people love putting, I find that hilarious, right, in some ways, because people are so fucking critical. But I'm noticing they're critical in all these different genres too, because I'm trying to research like what do people do well in all these different genres around the internet.
Yeah.
And I'm seeing this criticalness, it's all there, right? And I have noticed that too, right? Like someone goes broke and they're like, oh, he's broke, he's this, he's that. And there's a lot of other factors that determine if someone's good at poker or not. So if we're looking at someone's poker ability itself, then that's one thing. But I guess when you combine the whole entire like bankroll management, or you combine those things, then people try to like say, okay, well, let's look at the bankroll management. Let's look at the actual ability. Let's group those together. And now that defines this person, sort of thing like that. But to me, that doesn't, because there's other things that get in the way. There's downswings, as you said. There's just mismanagement. And there's a lot of these things that you need to be very, very good at in order to be this like well-rounded sort of, I guess, life manager in some ways when you're a poker player. And, you know, it's tough, man. It really is hard. It's not as easy as, I don't know if someone thinks it's easy or not. I don't think it's very easy to be a professional poker player in a lot of different ways. And there certainly are harder jobs out there. But in terms of kicking someone when they're down in that situation, or putting them down because of, for a number of different reasons, yeah, I think that is overblown in a lot of ways. But it also makes sense because we do glamorize money so much in poker.
Yeah.
And that is how we determine who's what, anything, right? Like we want to know who's winning, who's losing, who's got money, who doesn't have money. That's sort of something that's seemed to be born from the beginning of online poker and live poker, sort of thing like that. So it makes sense that people still react that way, because that used to be the reaction before. But I feel like as more people talk about it, and as we have this conversation, that narrative can then change, and then people can say, yeah, I mean, that's a good point, right? But no one talks about this kind of stuff.
Right.
So how can someone know that, oh, that makes sense, right? Like it is that regular when no one who has any influence is speaking about the issue.
Yeah.
I think this is where it starts, right?
Yeah, like, yeah.
This is the kind of thing.
And I think that's a huge issue, because at the end of the day, it is just a business, right? It's like people selling pieces, people being staked, whatever the case may be. Mm-hmm. It's crazy to look down on them. Could you imagine somebody opening like a local shop down the street and you like walking in and going, you only have half of yourself, you coward.
Right.
Like that's an insane thing. And we've like born this thing where it's like either you die a hero or you live long enough to become the villain. And those who stick around long enough are just probable to go broke because of all the variance and volatility. And now suddenly like we just tear them off their pedestals.
Well, I've noticed you had this reaction a lot. You have this response when people talk to you about selling action to play in high stakes games. And then your response is like, well, it's a business, right? Businesses get investors. Some people put up their own money. Some people get investors, but it's like, the most successful businesses, those people most of the time got investors for that. And that's sure. How they grew to that scale.
Yeah.
And the reason why they've had success at this high level is because they got investors. So I think when you frame it in that way, it makes a lot of sense. And I actually don't really know where this got started from, because it seems like what's happened and how this has got started is that the businessmen have put down the professionals right. in these higher stakes games, and that's their way to, it's like professionals insult the weaker players, and then the weaker players insult the professionals. Well, you only have 10% of yourself, buddy. Right. I got 100% of myself. I'll play like a fucking idiot if I want to, sort of thing like that. Yeah. So now it's like that message has been passed down, right? And now whenever people, now it's for some reason like amateur, like the fans are like, oh, well, I can't watch this. They only got 20% of themselves. And I kind of make sense. Like I kind of get that. But at the same time, you know, these guys do have skin in the game, right? These things do matter. And still doing well, even if you don't have a big piece, it still matters. It still matters for your ability to get staked in the future. It matters for your self-esteem. It matters for your ability to support your family or support whoever in the current time. So it does make sense to view it that way. And I don't know if this is like a big secret or not, but I mean, people are selling action for the 5-10 game too, and the 2-5, right? Like I don't know, like your friend Jimmy, right? Sometimes they sell action for these games. Like it isn't just exclusive to the highest stakes or for 10Ks. Like they're selling action everywhere, man. All the players are selling action, right? So it's like, I mean, are we glorifying people that don't sell action?
I think what it is this, like, I think like from the bottom up kind of routine or not routine, but like perspective, it's this feeling of being slighted in some capacity, right? Because almost everybody watching in some capacity has a level of poker dream or desire, whether that means that they see themselves playing the largest stake in the world, or it just means that they think they're going to make it from 50 cent a dollar to 5-10. Mm-hmm. Doesn't really matter. All that they can recognize is that people have unfair opportunities. And it's very easy to hate someone who has another person validate them through, you know, effectively investing. Like when you have a Bill Perkins come in and say, like, I believe in you enough to give you $1 million, whoever that person is, that's a big statement, you know?
It's true.
That's profound. It's like, this guy's made it. He recognizes like ability. And the big thing that's not quantifiable is skill. So those of us in the know who have been around for a long time, we recognize that the most skillful players are the ones that find the funding. But to the generally,
I agree.
Generally speaking.
I mean, we can talk about that topic though. Yeah.
Yeah. But to the outsiders looking in, it's just people find funding. Mm-hmm. And why not me? If you gave me $1 million, I'd win all of these high rollers. Mm-hmm. And that's ludicrous.
Well, I've actually not realized this was a skill until the past couple of years. And I think this is a huge skill, is your ability to navigate this world, to get in these games, to meet different people, to sell action, to sell yourself, to get staked. And I think people knew this a long time ago. I just never knew this was a thing.
Sure.
And the people that had been playing tournaments for a very long time, they've known this is, you got to sell yourself, right? You got to find that long-term relationship. You got to find these people that can piece you out for various events. You got to find the swaps. You got to buy the right action. You got to swap the right action. You got to make the right pieces. Like, I feel like these are very important things that you don't need it, right? But if your poker ability is just that good and that strong, but as the ecosystem evolves, then that becomes more important.
Yeah.
And maybe before you could have just, okay, I'm going to start from the bottom and move here, but games evolve and situations evolve. And that's where it seems to be evolving. And a lot of people seem very, they don't want to embrace that. They want to say, well, it just should be about who the best player is and whoever's there first and stuff like that.
Well, we equate money to skill so often. Like we interchange those and conflate the definitions. And that's just not true. Mm-hmm. You could be one of the most skillful and not see the return.
The most skillful players I have known are not playing poker because they mismanage their money, right? Like you want to talk about technical ability, right? Well, these guys have technical ability, but they don't know that you shouldn't play 6 hours versus 4 hours, and you shouldn't play six versus four tables, and you shouldn't go on upswing and then spend half of that money on something dumb, and then you go back, play the same stakes, and you lose it all, and you have no money to play.
Right.
Right? So, like, they don't understand that concept, and they don't understand how to get back in action if they get to that point. So that's what holds these players back, who are really good technical, theoretical players.
Yep.
So it's like, and after I think of this, right, like, the best players, I guess, to me, would maybe encompass all these ideas. They would have the theoretical knowledge. They would have the soft skills as well. They would have the ability to stay in action. Like, so then you look at who's been around the longest and who's playing some of these high stakes. And do those have to be the players, right?
That's the thing that bugs me the most, is that we don't spend enough time putting an emphasis on the total resume, right? It's just who's hot now, who's great lately. It's like there are so many flash in the pans, and not because they're not talented, not because they couldn't potentially be the greatest ever. It's just they haven't proven it. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, I don't think there will ever be any debate what Fedor's level of skill is, but he's much like Durr was in 2009. people were saying, like, this kid should be in the Hall of Fame. We don't know. We have no idea, right? Mm-hmm. And the fact of the matter is he's moved on to other things. So how impactful is Fedor or Adair back then going to be 10, 15 years from now down the line in the industry? And I think that, like, when you look at somebody like Rast, like, he might be one of the most glorified players from a resume standpoint that nobody on a couch sitting at home knows.
Right.
And it's crazy. And I mean, I don't know, like, to what point it impacts him, but it has to have some level of effect. It's like, this guy called his shot in the 50K to win it for a second time,
yeah,
where he bet like 300% on himself, just nailed it, won the 2015 Super High Roller Bowl. Like, he's just an afterthought in the poker sphere.
Well, I agree. And I from talking with him, I do have a feeling that this is probably something he thinks about, right? Because he's been playing some of the highest stakes online since, I mean, I can remember, like, 06, right? So 06, the guy's playing some of the highest stakes. I remember
he's 2 years older than me, so he's likely been around since 2002, 2003.
I remember I had a conversation with him before, and he said, like, a lot of people don't know this, but I'm battling in Bobby's room all the time. Like, I'm battling against the best players. I'm trying to become the best player in the entire world, but no one really knows that about me.
Mm-hmm.
I say, that's a good point. People don't really understand that about you. And I think what's happened is that I'm kind of like fixated by the hand, the crotch. They have like the hand.
Uh-huh.
You got the hand down. It's like very possible. I'm like, how did they not see possible, right? I'm like, got the phone down there. I'm like, this. What's happened?
I literally am holding on to the chair to like, I'm sitting on this like saddle thing that allows me to rock back and forth.
I'm like, I'm getting popped. I'm like, man.
I'll come above the table, man.
This is how possible wasn't detected. How did they not see it, right? It's like, well, man, people weren't looking at it.
Yeah.
Guys. Crutch or
that's it. You spent a month in an investigation. Now you're just fixated on dicks forever.
Oh my, it's ridiculous. But let's go back to that kind of topic there before. So we're talking about Brian. We were talking about kind of
just like the path forward. Like I don't think the clarity is there anymore.
Well, it seems like what's happening is that the only way for you to get known in poker right now is for you to let people know who you are.
Right.
And there is no media enterprise like UFC has. UFC creating their own original content around the athletes, and then the incentive is there for the athletes to participate because, one, it's contracted, and two, now you make more money through this. And it seems like these players don't, maybe this isn't true now to a lot of players out there, like, well, I'm not going to make more money or get more opportunity or get better at poker or get better opportunities. They see it this way. It doesn't matter. None of this matters.
Right.
It's either that or the people that are doing the media are just not seeking these opportunities out there. And from talking with a lot of the media people and kind of seeing how structures work and how incentives work, makes sense because there's no creative power a lot of times for these individual creators at the different media companies, and they don't make more for doing more in their minds, right?
Right.
Maybe they do long term, but sure, they don't make more in a short term. And the support systems aren't there. I don't know how to make graph. I don't know how to do this shit. So can someone help me? It seems like that support isn't there. So people just kind of get down and down, and they've been doing the same thing for years, and now they're whatever. Like they don't care as much, or they don't have the support, or someone doesn't care as much, or the monetary incentive isn't there amongst the companies. So that seems like how we get to this point in terms of with the media. And that's why now the only people that really get themselves out there are people who actively choose to. And you know, I guess sucks in a way, because now even you have these guys like the Stephen Chidwicks and the top Cale Burns, and you got these guys Sam Salverl, not really known amongst poker fans, and we can debate if they should be or not should be, but the only way these guys are really going to get known is if they keep playing these games for the next like maybe 6 years,
right?
And then eventually it's like, oh, now I've seen him for 10 years, I know who he is.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
Or somebody creates something about them on a consistent basis to get that repetitive marketing out there, but that doesn't seem to be being done. And instead, people like myself, people like yourself, people like the vloggers, people like the streamers, those are now becoming these influencers in some way in the community only by, I guess, effort, right? Like they put in the effort.
Yeah, it's literally by default. Like
we
are completely devoid of media outlets. And that's not saying there aren't media outlets. Of course, Card Player, Poker News, Poker Central, these places all exist.
Mm-hmm.
But like, for instance, I woke up today and wanted to see who made the final table of Poker Masters.
Right.
Couldn't find it. Couldn't find it anywhere.
Yeah.
I mean, if I can't Google Poker Masters 2019 final table and find it, that's a problem.
Mm-hmm.
That's a huge issue. And then, you know, on top of that, we start to layer things behind paywalls. And, you know, when we start going down the other media outlets, it's like most of the stuff that they're putting out there is paid or backed by whatever it is that they're supporting. There just isn't a lot of incentive any longer to get out there, be on the beat, And, you know, it's old hat too. You know, how many times can we watch an interview of a guy on break who's the chip leader talking about a few hands when is when?
Hello, everyone. You're watching PokerNews.com, and welcome back to our coverage of the Super High Roller Bowl. I am with Matt Berkey. Now, let's just start off with, it looks like things are going pretty well for you. You're amassing a pretty solid stack, and I would say you were kind of a sleeper in this field. Like, a lot of people that know you knew that you were going to crush, but maybe a lot of people out there didn't know. So tell me a little bit about what's going on.
That's probably a bit of an understatement. I'm sure I was a pretty favorable dog in the field.
That's true, right? It is kind of this... I mean, I guess we can debate, right? Maybe are some interesting or some not. But I think what happens is there's content created so much that is either marketed poorly or just, I guess really it's the marketing a lot of ways. Because when you look at other industries and what's successful and what's not, it's because they build up a narrative and a story around the content that they're trying to put out there. And then they sell that story and they promote the story.
Yep.
So, I mean, I think UFC is just this great example because that's something I've really studied a lot. And Dana White, who's in charge of UFC, considers himself a promoter. That's what his job is. I'm going to promote thy fights. Mm-hmm. How do you promote a fight? Well, you build up this story around the fight with the people. So you make the story, people care about the story, you care about the people. Now you care about what's going to happen in this thing. Are they going to win? Are they going to lose? Like, I know a little bit more about these guys.
Right.
It seems like what happened in poker is that was the initial approach with World Series of Poker and World Poker Tour back in the day. So they build up these stories, these narratives, the truck drive, even like the professionals got stories. And now what seems to be the case is that I don't know what exactly happened. They've disregarded these stories. So now a guy like Sam Salverall and Steven Chidwick, we've been playing poker a long time. Like, I don't really even know anything about a lot of these guys, right?
Yeah.
And now are we saying there isn't a story there? Because I would disagree. I think there is a story. If I really dug in, could spend a couple hours. If you really dig in and spend a couple hours, you're going to come up with some type of story that connects us to these people to make us give a fuck about them as a poker fan or as a poker whatever, right? So it seems like that's really gone away. And this is a big reason why I've been thinking about this whole vlogger thing. I have never been able to figure this out. And I've got a few things on why I think vloggers are so popular and why they're going to continue. They're like, that's the path that has the most, I guess, like growth in terms of way. And that's because you get to know who these people are, right? It doesn't matter. These are the best players, right? At least we know something about the guys, right? We know.
And they're doing a great job coordinating amongst each other too.
Big thing.
Yeah. Huge crossover markets. They make it so that they're a character base rather than just a solo individual.
Right.
And I think now all of a sudden, like, people are tuned in. They do give a shit. You know, there's room for like competitions and stuff like that. Utilizing the UFC model, I think, is what Poker Central had in mind. And I really do think that, like, they're the one entity that could change the game.
Yeah.
The problem is, I feel like they implemented the business strategy backwards. UFC started with everything for free, mm-hmm. right? And then they scored a Spike deal, and all of a sudden Ultimate Fighter became a show. And then off of all of that was born the app, where now you can get UFC 24/7.
Right.
We did it the other way here, where we have poker 24/7. It's not 24/7. And now all of the things that need to be pumped out over a general audience are being pushed behind the paywall.
Mm-hmm.
And I worry, because it's a good opportunity for people like Poker News and other outlets to really seize that and put out the best free content. There's just no incentive.
Yeah, I mean, also, when you learn more about how these structures work and how the systems work inside, and it makes sense, right? Like, anytime you see a company or kind of someone you think maybe could do a better job. I mean, I think I do a better job. We can all do a lot of better jobs. Yeah. But when you really take an outside look, and you're able to see things that they're not able to see inside too, just because they've been entrenched so long. So, like, I think I could come into S4Y and I could be like, probably give three ideas that you'd be like, oh, that's a good fucking idea.
Yeah.
You could come into what I'm doing, you could be like, give me three ideas. And I'd be like, that's a good fuck. Like, right. But it's when we're inside and you know, that it's real. I think it'd be tough that ways too. And as you mentioned, the incentive, what is the incentive? Right.
There's, like, no alignment. There's no reason why Poker News would ever want to bolster Poker Central. There's like, nobody ever wants to coordinate. That's like the biggest issue I find in the community as a whole, mm-hmm. whether you're talking about media, training, tournament tours, even like cash games and casinos and stuff like that. There is so much that can be done with even the most like small amount of coordination,
mm-hmm.
where instead we just, like, because right now the market's not being policed, And we're just trusting that the general populace is going to know what media outlet to gravitate to, what right. training sites to gravitate towards, what casino to gravitate towards to play tournaments, cash, whatever. And then you see things like the Venetian thing get snuck in there and it's in the fine print. And, you know, yeah. we did our best to call it out and there was a decline, I'm sure. But it wasn't by any means an ultimate failure, mm-hmm. you know, and this just happens. It's broken across the board.
It's a great point. It's so a like, really good point.
I wonder, or I guess like I'd like to hear your take on what do you think the future landscape of the community has in separate entities? Because I do think that it's a hard divide right now. Mm-hmm. There are grinders and then there's content grinders because of all the lack of that exposure otherwise. So how do you see that like overlap? And do you think the community is just going to like overtake pretty much all of big media?
You mean communities in terms of the sub communities with like the vloggers have there, SolveTheWise got there. Yeah. I
Reddit, like all the forums.
Well, it's definitely happening now. Yeah. Right. And I think that the only way that changes is if someone starts a media site in a way, and I've had offers to do this and I've put a lot of, I kind of like planned it out recently. Actually, I was like, how would this work? Right. Well, what other media? I just study other areas. Right.
Right. Right.
I just study, okay, what are these other areas doing? And okay, that works well. So what could the poker equivalent sort of be? And when you look at what other areas do, there really isn't anything like that in poker as well too. And you mentioned a good idea, like a very good point, right? It's like, where do you go for this information? Because if we have some trouble finding some of these things, then imagine, you know, Tony over there in Sacramento or something like that. Tony wants to go play and he's like, I'm going to Vegas. Where do I play? Right.
Right.
You ask someone on Twitter, you ask me on Twitter, you ask an Andrew Nimi on Twitter. It's like, where do you go for this information? And it does seem like there's a massive opening. And then the argument is like, well, then how do you monetize this opening? And then that's where the trouble comes in, is because
for sure.
you monetize it through a deal with the site.
Right.
You say, okay, like PokerStars, okay, you want to support.
Or any advertisers, but in poker, yeah.
Right. That would be the direct path. Or right. you do up, like, let's say Solve4Y, right? Solve4Y, do you want to pay $2,000 to advertise, be one of the main people on my poker media site? Mm-hmm. Well, Solve4Y is like, you don't want to, maybe you don't want to promote Upswing. Maybe you don't. And then you say Upswing, you want to come in. Like, you don't want to. So it's like this, right. as you mentioned, the collaboration is, and what's probably going to have to happen is somebody who is able to collaborate with these people would have to start something, right? Like, I would have to start something, yeah. or I don't, there's other people out there who can pull people together, but it's like, everyone's kind of so segregated, man.
Well, yeah. I mean, you know, the thing is we all got into this industry for independence.
Yeah.
That's the big thing.
Oh yeah. But
if we wanted to see this machine churn along and start really cranking, mm-hmm. what you would see is some umbrella controlling training sites, not controlling, but like coordinating,
right.
some umbrella coordinating media, some umbrella coordinating poker tours. But yeah, that's, you know, you're talking like Rob Young level of wealth that would need to step in and say, hey, I'm willing to take a loss because I see big picture growth here in right. some capacity. And to be quite honest, the metrics just don't kind of lean that way.
Right. I mean, you know, it's a gamble, right? And I look at it as a gamble. And I think this is how Poker Central views it, is like, they don't mind doing it this way now. But if, I think it all rests on, does American poker become legalized again?
Sure.
So it's sort of like a huge gamble. In that, well, let's say that never happens, then it doesn't matter, right? We're going to probably fail. But the upside is so massive if we're entrenched or established as this premier destination, once that might happen, which I think that will happen at some point in time, especially now that I'm sort of seeing, we'll get to that after if you'd like to, because the Andrew Yang thing is going to, when I do that, and yep. I've been putting a lot of thought into this whole legalization for poker thing, and I have a lot of theories on what the current, I guess, why it isn't legalized and that type of thing like that. So, but I do see that these communities are going to rise more and more, and simply because they're putting an effort. So if you have the media sites that aren't putting in the amount of effort that all of us are putting in, then how are they ever going to become this place that people can go to talk when all these other subgenres are now building up people? And it seems like, you know, a good opportunity. I was thinking about this the other day, is like, you cover what's happening in vlogger news. Like, you're like the right. ESPN of fucking poker vloggers.
Yeah.
And
I think like PokerTube tried to do that at a low level. It's
yeah,
just
yeah.
The difficulty is getting traction. But I actually did have an idea that coordinated with that. We just haven't had the resources to really implement it yet.
Mm-hmm.
And it was going to be a challenge where we got six vloggers and then ourselves. And let's say it lasts for 20 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
And at the end, like the person or the vlogger who wins gets like a main event seat or something of like that nature. And it was just going to be a That's simple cool. competition.
I love that.
Yeah, everybody gets a day to vlog. So like, you know, if you're Monday and Boski's Tuesday and Nimi's Wednesday, and ultimately it would land on a Sunday wrap-up that we would do,
mm-hmm.
where we would do it just like news desk style, and it would be like, this is what happened throughout the course of the week. And it was just a good way to like push content. But the coordination, man, it's so hard, and you need so many resources, because to incentivize six other people to coordinate with you to create content, you need to give them more than a platform. They already have that.
Right.
So you need to incentivize them with ROI in some capacity. And it's like, they have to care about that ROI.
Right. I think the better relationships you have with them, the better, right? Like you almost, right?
Right.
Like
what
you've done. Like, I mean, I don't know. That's how I've always like approached these things. And I try to have a relationship in some capacity with everybody in poker, and I never really ask for anything. But if people ask me for something, I try to help them out a large majority of the time. And I think that's, right, that's how you have these relationships in some ways, since you just try to be who you are, and if people like that, they do. If they don't like that, they don't. And
yeah,
right. And
I think all right, so I think that's a really good segue to something else that I'd love to dig into.
Sure.
Personally, I was always the exact opposite.
Mm-hmm.
Grew up hyper competitive, played sports my whole life. Like, to me, poker was a battlefield up until probably, I don't know, after I went broke the last time, hopefully in 2012.
We've all been there.
Yeah. Getting through that, like, I relied so much on the small subset of friends that I collected throughout to get by, that I kind of did start to realize, you know, how much more important like the overall community was. I was paying a lot closer attention to things that were going on around me. And there was a desire to both give back, but also like reach levels of coordination. I think it's kind of like being in the cash mindset too, where like, You don't get to be buddy-buddy with people like you do in tournaments, because they're taking ROI directly away from you
mm-hmm.
when you're sitting across the table. But what I'm trying to get to is, effectively, like, I never built that huge network. It was never something that really interests me. Now, obviously, the position I'm in, I wish I had. But you seem to always have that when you hit the ground running.
Mm-hmm.
So I was digging through, like, the old Poker Life podcast. First of all, let's just call you out a little bit here.
Okay.
Not in a negative way, but... You were a vlogger before vlogging was a thing.
I'm trying to tell people that. I did. I had one of like the first vlogs, I think. I mean, other people had vlogs in Poker Road and stuff like that, but yeah. I
loved Poker Road.
Oh yeah. Man. I didn't know the fuck I was doing, man. When I just record YouTube videos, I was like, hey, I'm in this like restaurant in Vancouver. I'm gonna play 160 hours this week.
What's up, guys? Joe Ingram 1, aka Chicago Joey here. I'm just getting ready to set the world record, and for most hands played today, 50,000 hands plus. I'm very excited about it. I'm ready to prove that I am the ultimate grinder in the whole entire world of the online poker. I'm going to show you guys a little bit about my setup and how I plan on doing it. I have my three monitors right here, guys. I'm going to just basically 24 table stack on this one monitor right here. I got all my keyboards. I got my other monitor right here. I'm going to watch TV shows. Right now, we got a little Real Housewives of Orange County on there. I'm loving this show totally right now. How am I going to do it? How am I going to play 24 hours straight? People are asking, how do you do it? 50,000 hands. It's so many hands. It's easy. I don't take any drugs. I don't need that Adderall bullshit. I'm a fucking natural. Natural drug free. I got my Red Bull right here. Boom. Take about maybe 10, 15 of these the whole entire time. Help me stay awake. Gummy worms. Gummy bears. More gummy worms. This is basically going to help me stay nourished throughout my whole entire time. Got my eye drops. My eyes get watery. Take my eye drops. I need to stay awake. Pretty simple. Comforter on the chair right here. Keep me warm when I'm playing, you know, just take a nap, whatever, however I want to do it. Ultimately, how am I going to go to the bathroom, people ask? What are you going to do? How are you going to get up and pee? Well, that's easy. Going to the bathroom while you're playing, that shit's for noobs. Pissing in the bottles right down here, that's just for the pros. There's no bathroom needed. I just simply open up the bottle, take it right here, and just start going pissing in the bottle. But at some point in time, I'm going to need some relaxation. And that's when I have to switch chairs to my lazy boy recliner right here. And then it's gonna be time for a little massage for my massage girl.
Hey boys, I'm here to help Joe Ingram 1, the best grinder in the world, achieve the world record.
Basically what I'm gonna be doing is just getting a massage right here. Have my mouse in front of me, click, 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 script, script, script. And after 24 hours, the world record for most hands in a day is gonna be mine. And I'm gonna be $30,000 richer from playing some NL25. I hope you guys follow along on the webcam. This is Joe Ingram 1, aka Chicago Joey.
Yeah, yeah. Like everything seemed to be very goal oriented, which I think makes sense a little bit. I know about you. Seems like you're very driven by not necessarily intrinsic things, but also not necessarily money. Just mm-hmm. more so like I'm going to do this thing and watch as I try.
Pretty much. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Not money. I've been thinking about this a lot. Not money. No, I need to go the other way. I'm too far this way with money.
Yeah. Well, there's so many things to dig into, but I think anybody who's had any relative success where you've had more money than you can fathom and then lost it, I think it's pretty easy to realize that just like no amount is ever enough. Like right. security is your only main issue, but that gets met at a pretty low bar.
Right.
And then from that point forward, it's just a video game trying to run up a high score. So it's like that can't be the center focus of things.
Mm-hmm.
But I want to stick a pin in that for a second just because I think that goes off into a way deeper tangent.
Very deep.
So prior to creating the YouTube content, the first thing I saw was coming off the back end of your prop bet.
Mm-hmm.
The 50,000 hands.
2009. Yeah.
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 50,000 hands, 24 hours.
Yeah. That was my second big bet I did. Yeah.
And you had to be profitable.
Yeah. I made 43 buy-ins.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay. How much was the bet for?
33,000.
1-to-1?
No, 3-to-1. Okay. 3.5-to-1. I put up something still. To win 33K.
Yeah, yeah,
that was
yeah.
the second bet. The first year before, I did 600,000 hands in a month, which is the most hands ever in full ring in a month.
Yeah.
And that wasn't profitable, but I still was. And then year later, the same month, November, I'm like, I feel like doing another bet. And these people want to bet against. I was like a volume like master, basically. I would always post these 10 to 30,000 hand graphs all the time. That was like what I was known for in 2+2 at that time.
Mm-hmm.
And then I was like, well, can I bet this again? And everyone's like, nah, you can't do it. You can't do it. I'm like, okay, I mean, whatever, fine. So,
right.
But I already knew I could do it. I've done it before. So yeah. I did it 20 hours, made 40 some
I think the profitable part is what's the most impressive there.
Yeah, I don't know how. I mean,
it was 2009, fair, but like.
It's kind of laughable looking back because it was at, my stats were at six, it was at six max and I barely played six max. I was just, that's the only place I could get 50,000 hands in a day. And I was playing like, 12-9 or something like that. But I also knew how to game select really well 24 tabling, which some people might say, what are you talking about? But I think I was one of the best 24 table game selectors that may have ever existed because I had a system down where I had my lobby here and I have this here and I would just, it'd be like normal, right? And I could obviously be focusing more on the game, but the game was the tables, right? So I would start tables. I'd always have an empty table open. I'd always be scanning for seats. And this is what has allowed me to be able to game select at a level I can without a seat script or anything like that. It's just because I developed these strategies over time in terms of like getting in good games, getting in good seats, like mastering that whole process. And it started from doing that. And it was just like, I don't know why I did it initially, but I always end up on these tables where it's like all regulars and we're all playing tight. I'm like, the fuck out of here. Let me start a new table.
Yeah, yeah.
It was just like, that seemed like the best way to do it. And then in the process, I learned shorthanded, learned heads up and learned how to do that.
Was this all PLO or no limit?
No limit. This is all hold'em. Okay. This was all hold'em. I switched to PLO 2010 to get Supernova Elite. And then I switched the next year to get Supernova Elite again. And then I just stuck with PLO after that.
So Black Friday obviously had to be a huge impact for you specifically. As best I can gather, you weren't like putting in a lot of live volume, right?
No, I really never played live before that. I played some live as like a fish and I would lose all my money oftentimes when I was younger. But yeah, it was awful. I mean, it was the best thing in retrospect. Like I probably never would have left San Diego and I would have stayed there forever. But it did force me to take what I was doing more seriously because I was in this constant thing where I'd shot take, like play 10, 20, 20, 50, lose, go back down, $50, kind of go back up. It was just like, I was so bad with bankroll management. And to me, like, it wasn't even about that. I just wanted to get to 50, 100, 100, 200, 200, 400 and play high stakes.
Yeah.
So it didn't I didn't care if I had 40K to play 200, 400. It didn't matter to me at all.
Right.
I was like, I'll still do it. And if I lose, I'll go back to $50, make it back. And because I always knew, I did it so many times to drop down 10 and 10, 25 cent, 25 and 50 cent, $50. I didn't mind at all. So I would lose 10K in a day sometimes, go play 25 cents, 50 cents, make back 1,500. I did this all the time too.
Man, I was the exact opposite being a live guy.
Well, I mean, how can you do it live? Can you imagine?
Well, no.
I didn't even know you could do that.
I mean like marrying live to online. So I treated online like live. I would one table everything.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
And
wow.
Like, I would really go through the pain because like, obviously I would still do, I've never been rolled for anything I've ever done.
Mm-hmm.
It's just like, what's the biggest game in the room? I think I'm the most skillful player. Let me sit. And ironically, the first time I went broke was through PLO. So I played a lot of heads up PLO.
Great game.
I played a lot of heads up PLO from like 05, 06-ish to like 2009, 2010.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
And Full Tilt, right?
When I say a lot, I mean like relative to any other game I was playing online. I was mostly still playing live.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're still probably talking about like only 10 or 20,000 hands a year.
Mm-hmm.
But I would develop these like rivalries. Man, me and Wiggins, we used to just battle.
Andrew Wiggins?
Yeah. Yeah. That was great. But the way I ended up going broke was 2006, I had back-to-back scores on Party Poker, won the nightly two nights in a row,
mm-hmm.
and would just like shot take. So I'd just be playing like 2-4, 5-10 PLO all the time. And I was just like riding the dragon, man. Some days I would just like kill it and I'd be like, this is it. We're gonna have $1 million by the end of the week.
Yeah.
No big deal. And then other days it would be like, just had a 20K downswing. I don't know how I'm gonna deal with this. But I fluctuated basically between like, you know, 40 and 60K over and over. So Christmas was about to roll up, the end of 2006.
Mm.
And I decided that night was gonna be, well, it was decided for me, Joey. It was decided for me.
Okay.
I sat one table, 5-10 PLO,
uh-huh.
ran a little bad. I had a couple tables of 5-10 PLO going,
uh-huh.
ran a little bad.
Mm.
And I had a couple tables of 25-50 going, ran a little bad. Next thing I know, I have six tables of Full Tilt, six tables of Poker Stars, all 25-50 PLO. The whole 60K is on the line. Just, it was honestly like something out of a video game.
Yeah.
Just like watching one table after another go down because I didn't have another buy-in. I was left with like $12,000, sent 5K immediately to my student loans because I felt like a piece of shit. And then just licked my wounds and figured it out.
We've all been there. We've all been. I mean, listen, that's like we have not.
It's
all
like
been
one
there.
Tenth
we have
of
not
what
all been there at home, technically. But
it's like one tenth what happened to you.
We've all done that, right? Not in one night. That's I've never done the whole one.
It would never happen over multiple nights. That's the thing. I was out of my mind.
Right.
You know, so, I was young. I was 24, 25. Just came into this money. I didn't know what the hell I was doing.
This has definitely happened to me, actually. I'm thinking more about it. But you played heads up, which is so much more volatile. And the thing is,
we were playing 6 and 9 max by the end of it all.
I don't know. I'm like, kind of savage. All right, you're 12 tabling heads. I'm like, I could see you 12 tabling heads. Why not? I could see you doing that.
Firing anything that would open. Like, I'm pretty sure Galfon got a nice chunk of it. I remember Leggy was like one of the regs back then. He got a big piece.
Galfon always gets a piece of it. I'm telling you, right? I'm pretty sure he got a piece of me, too. Back when I had a upstream down, you know, it's like, I think we all have that. That bit, and with this attitude, right? If you get a lot of money at some point, you're gonna have this massive downswing because it's like that. I feel like this leak is always there in some ways, and it can go away at some point.
Like,
I don't know. Maybe that's how you get there in the first place.
That's what I'm saying. Like, I'm just wondering if like maybe it's a necessary callus to build, where it's like I'll never do that again. Like, I went broke other ways later, but like mm-hmm. I'll never do that again.
Right. It's a good question, man. Because it's something like this. You know, happened to me where I knew what my leak was. It was playing too many tables and playing against good players in that process, right? Because the better players you play against with the more tables, the more very deep decisions that you have to make against other players who are thinking very deeply about things, which means that you have to exert more energy against these spots. And I never really realized this over time. I was like, I'm 24 table mid stakes. Like I can 12 table high stakes,
sure.
Right?
Yeah.
And what I realize in retrospect was that my strategy to get to higher stakes was heavy game selection and just less tables. And I would play against better players, but I would play less tables. So I'd be able to focus more on the decisions I'm making and then therefore get better more rapidly in real time. And then once I deviated from that strategy, once I stopped being focused is when everything falls apart and you sort of look and you say, well, was I a bad player or did I have a bad strategy? And oftentimes it was that you were a winning player, and if you kept doing your strategy normally, you probably would have been one of the top players, right? Or one of the best winners. But you were a fucking idiot, and you deviated from what you knew was a proven winning strategy to a strategy that just had a lot more variance, and you were on the wrong side of the variance there. So it's like, I think if you can grasp that concept of what did I do wrong? Okay, I'm not going to do that again. And you know that I think it's that sort of thing that you sort of have to master.
It's like, I think that's the at the end of the day, that's like one of the best parts of pursuing this career is it's a real character building path.
Can be.
And there's like no getting around it. But like, all right, so for your career path, as was Black Friday comes,
mm-hmm.
when was like your, I guess, ultimate peak? Like, when were you the richest? When did you feel the most successful, pre or post Black Friday?
Oh, definitely after Black Friday. I mean, before Black Friday, I never really had more than a 30, 40, 50K roll. I mean, I kind of did, but I'd always shot take all the time.
Yeah, yeah, like, yeah, sure.
every single day I could be playing up to 10-20 or up down to 25-70 cent. It was just like, and it would be no rhyme or reason sometimes too. I would just decide to play a 15,000 hand session sometimes at 50 cent dollar, because I did like the VPP system, the reward system on PokerStars, and I always had like, maybe I'll go for Supernova Elite this year, maybe not, which was 100 million VPPs, which mean you had to play a few million hands. So higher stakes you played, the more points you got. So I would always kind of flirt with that idea, but it was definitely 2000 and poker career wise, 2012 when I was in Vancouver. Yeah, Vancouver. It's all in Vancouver. All the good stuff happened in Canada, basically.
Sure.
And then once I had that large amount of success, here's what happened, right? Is that never in my life did I ever really like get out of line. Okay. I just kind of, not like in that out of line, like traditional aspect you might consider out of line. When I was 21, I moved to the city of Chicago, and I was working at a restaurant called Lucky Strike, and I was working for a promotional modeling company where they would basically pay you to go to events. So as I was doing that, I was like, oh, it's fun, right? You get paid to go to events and have a good time or promote something. So I started doing something with like a nightclub kind of thing there, like a bar nightclub thing. So I started working for this thing, and they would just pay me to go to these places, and I would get people to go there. So I would drink a little bit there. That's the first time I ever drank when I was 21. So I would drink, and I was like, oh, this is, you know, this is different, right? Because you're just, it's like, it's a lot of fun, right? You know, a lot of fun, a lot out of line, right? I'm sleeping on friends' couches and stuff like that. I would sleep anywhere before I was really even staying in the city. I was crashing on couches. I just figured out how to navigate this world to stay there, even though I live in the suburbs. Then I moved there, and I was like, yeah, I can't drink like I anymore. It's just, this is just, you know, ridiculous, right? So I just was getting too crazy. So I stopped drinking, essentially. And I very rarely ever drank before I'm 22 up to 27. So I never tried smoke, never tried a drug, like anything like that. It was just always, my mom taught me that was bad.
Yeah.
It's like, don't smoke, don't drink, don't do drugs. I'm like, okay, well, I trust my mother, right? I'm not going to do these things. And then 27 comes. And what happened was I had so much success at poker. And I was like, this is all I've ever wanted, right? My whole entire goal was to get to high stakes and get a few a few hundred thousand dollars. Like that was, I got there and I was like, well, what else we got, right? Like what else is out there in the world? And then I was always good at saying no to every distraction around me, except women. And not to that extreme though, but
sure.
The friends, like I was always like in Vancouver, I'm like, they always, you know, you want to go out, you want to do this, you want to do that. And I would go out occasionally, have a drink here and there, but it was never anything I got too into. But I decided now I could do that, right? I don't need to focus as much. I'm good at I got a good strategy. I can allow some fun into my life. And I allowed that fun into my life. And then I experienced emotions I never experienced before in terms of like happiness and in terms of enjoyment, in terms of connection with friends and that sort of level. And I was like, well, this is a lot of fun.
Yeah.
And then I didn't really know any better because I never really tried to grow these close connections with friendships to this level that I was building them in Canada. And then they said, you want to try these things? Do you want to have fun? You want to try, you know, the ecstasy, these kind of things like that? And I said, well, yeah, why not? And then you go out and you do those things. And if those allow you to access this sort of happiness feeling that you may never experience in your life. And I never experienced it in my life up until that point. So I said, well, this is quite fun, right? Why don't they, you know, let's do more of this kind of thing like that.
Yeah.
And I think what happened was, is that as I became less disciplined for poker and as it stopped being my main focus, and as my mind started allowing these distractions to come in, and I found, well, I enjoy this. I enjoy going out. I enjoy dancing. I enjoy festivals. I like traveling. I never really allowed any of that to come into my life previous to that. And then once I took that to a little bit more extreme in terms of the distractions with women and drugs, were basically like the kind of, you know, I wouldn't say like you say they're the downfall. The reason why they're a downfall is that they're a downfall of the success that you pursued in one category and you were so focused on that. And then once you lose that focus, the discipline stops being there and other things become more important to you. And then, you know, that's what happens, right?
Yeah.
And that's really what happened to me. And I mean, it teaches you a big lesson in a lot of ways. Kind of you mentioned earlier about the whole money thing and you realize it's not about the money. And then I realized like it wasn't about that for me. It was just about the pursuit of that success to get to the top level of the game. That was really all I wanted to get to. And that's what I've always kind of done in my life is I wanted to be as good as I can at whatever I kind of did and dedicated my time to.
Yeah.
So I think that's what happened. It's just I wanted to experience more. It's out there in life. And then I did experience it. And then It turns out I didn't manage my life correctly, right?
Well, I think a lot of us are like wired that way, and that is why we gravitate towards poker, in the sense that it's not about chasing the money necessarily. It's just about the journey in and of itself. And we create these lofty goals, and then you achieve them, and you kind of get there, and you're like, well, what next?
Yeah.
And you just start looking around at the next big thing that seems impossible to do. And, you know, as best as I can tell, this is like your late 20s. It makes sense. I personally went through something very similar, not at all same path, but like around the same time frame, I was like 30. I had gone broke, and I just found myself for like 12 months, 15 months on the couch going through the self-actualization process where it's like, what have I sacrificed to get to this point? How much of that was worth it? You know, how much do I need to put emphasis on being well-rounded, creating strategies outside of this game, but actually for life and everything else? And, you know, in a lot of ways, the same kind of thing happened where for you, it was like these festivals and women and drugs and all these other distractions. You're applying that same level of dedication and and pursuit that you were towards this high stakes dream.
Yeah. Bad idea.
Yeah. And I mean, like, you
know, recommend that.
I think that we talked a little bit like off air on this. It's really difficult when you commit yourself to such an unrelenting game that will just like beat you to your knees over and over again, but you keep getting up and pushing forward. It's hard to find that balance elsewhere. Like, you know, I'm 37. So like, I feel like I'm fucking ancient in this community. I mean, even you're 34. It's like you're getting to the point where like you're a decade further along than the up and comers and stuff like that. We have to navigate the real world now.
Yeah.
You know, like we have to start to consider answering some bigger questions that I've probably visited and revisited 10 times over throughout my life, but can't seem to wrap my head around. It's like, what about family? What about kids? What about like partners and all these other big relationships? And, you know, I kind of mentioned to you that like over the last couple of months, I found myself back there in that same place that I was when I was broke, where it's just like kind of taking inventory of like, man, since starting this business and dedicating myself wholeheartedly to a dream I want to achieve, I've been shitty.
Yeah.
I'm just shitty all around. I'm a bad friend. I'm a bad boyfriend. I'm a bad grandson. I'm a bad uncle. Like, I just don't give people any of myself. And it's just like, how do you stop this perpetual cycle where there's still a desire to be an individual?
Right. Well, this is anytime people wonder where I disappear, when I disappear from Twitter and Instagram and content, this is where I go. Is I've been studying this since basically July. And the past 3 weeks is all I've kind of been studying these questions and these bigger things and trying to just take in all this knowledge from around the world and different parts of the world. In terms of right now, I've been deep in like history and sort of like how power structures have worked in the past, what, hundreds of years sort of thing, and how the world came to be. And then kind of studying these other questions of family and of nutrition and of these things and seeing how they all sort of work together. And basically asking myself these questions I never thought about. And those are the same things for me. It's like, I have such a tough time, because anytime you answer one question, then there's six more questions pop up. And then it's like, well, the question, I'm trying to figure out what are the base fundamental questions and how do I build those up? And then sort of, and now it's like, well, why do relationships matter? And then why does family matter? And how does that work with myself, sort of thing like that? So I've kind of had the same realizations. I talked about them on a couple of my shows too, but yeah, those are very common thoughts I have as well. And I don't know the answers to these questions. So it's very tough to figure out.
All right, everyone, that's a wrap on this week's Vlogcast. Be sure to tune in next week as we dig into part two of my interview with Joe Ingram. We're going to dive into relationships as a poker player, the industry as a whole, training, as well as what his next steps are going to be moving forward, both as a content creator and a professional.